I tell you two slides before about the Wollmucks. Our part of technical consolidation within the Office migration. There are some functions on this slide I think you can't read. For example, letterhead system, automatic fill-in of user data and ensure our corporate design, a formula system, a text module system, and many more comfortable functions. These are functions we need in a public authority every day. And we had great solutions for this requirements for Microsoft Office, based on Visual Basic for applications, based on something else, I don't know. Many solutions, but for the future, we took the opportunity to get one solution, platform-independent solution, self-developed, and we call it Wollmucks. It's Java-based and an open office extension, and why do I talk so much about this Wollmucks? You can try it. We published the Wollmucks under the EUPL, the European Union Public License. It's a GPL-like free software license adopted for European law, and so it's much more easy for European public authorities to give software back as free software using this license. Because the GPL has some American background, the UPL is, I would say, something like the GPL, but with an European background, and maybe in the future there's one license, I'll hope, and the Free Software Foundation, together with the European Commission, are talking about this. Have a look at wollmucks.org if you're interested, and try it. So, I think much more interesting for you than the Wollmucks is, what about our base client, our Linux basis client, as we call it, and our business applications? That are the main components of our base client. Yes, again, you couldn't read it. We use Debian Linux as our distribution at the base for everything other. And we do not have, maybe it's reported in some news media, we do not have any own distribution based on Debian. No, we use pure Debian Linux. Of course, there are some backports, but I think not more than 5 backports. For example, a newer OpenOffice, a newer Firefox, a newer Thunderbird, iStuff, iSweezel, I know the discussion. But we are using pure Debian. We do not have any own distribution. We use KDE, we use OpenOffice, and for software distribution, another popular product, a very popular software for you, fully automatic installation, FAI, for distributing our clients. Some screenshots, the login screen, our desktop, and okay, the KDE booting screen. Yes, maybe you can see something, but the slides will be online afterwards. I'm at DevConf, though I have to thank people here at DevConf for this great work you're doing. Thank you very much for Debian Linux. It's really a great work, and we are using it, and we do not have any problems, though we can use it. Thank you. One special, yes, it's you, it's up to you. It's your work. One special thing I want to stress. In the past, we had a roadshow throughout our departments in the city to talk to the end users, to our employees who maybe have been afraid of what's coming on this. You're switching to free software, and it's software written from people sitting in backyards programming using Coke and chips and don't know about daylight. And we showed them the first time our development client, and I don't lie, one people told me, wow, there's a graphical user interface. I didn't even know. Another one told me, wow, my colleague told me that I have to use a very popular text editing software called VI or something like this to write my letters, and I see there's something like Microsoft Office. It was Open Office here. Wow! Yes, that was the point in Munich from our employees in 2003. So we decided to be certified for usability. The TÜV, I don't know any English translation for TÜV, offered us to do a usability certification for our client. And we did this, and in the end, we had a certificate of, or we have a certified Linux client for his great usability. Of course, this was a marketing argument for us to our employees. Nothing special. We didn't develop something new to a Linux client. We just customized something. We, for example, we changed the background color. We're discussing the right background color together with our doctor service. It has to be a non-aggressive background color. It has to be, I don't know what they told, but it was a five-hour discussion to together with our doctor service what background color to use. But in the end, we have been certified, and I say that that wasn't a certificate from Munich. For us, that's just a marketing argument. It was also certified for free software as whole, because no other client, not even any Microsoft operating system, had until this time a certificate for usability. So free software is standard. Free software is really usable, and it was certified by one of the most important German offices. The requirements to our client. It's the same situation like before our Open Office migration. The city of Munich is not one city administration. Of course, we are one city administration, but there are about 21 independent units, departments, and units in the city running their own IT. So they invented the wheel again and again and again, and we are doing the same in this place, and nobody knows about the others. So the migration to our Linux base client is a great opportunity for us to consolidate and to standardize even on the technical level for the infrastructure. For example, software distribution. In the past in Munich, there have been great automated solutions, proprietary products. You can talk, tell them, distribute 5,000 clients through the night and start every distribution 5 minutes ago, and the next 5 minutes, and so on and so on. And there have been other software distribution utilities in Munich using a CD and walking from workstation to workstation. So it's a great opportunity for us to do some consolidation in the infrastructure. Another one, opportunity to do consolidation on applications. There are about 300 business applications. Okay, we can't consolidate them because business applications are specialized to fulfill exactly this business task they are written for. But there are about another 300 applications, we call it standard applications, for example, for HTML editing. We have a great content management system, what you see is what you get, and so on. But in the past, we have every web editor software you can imagine. FrontPage, GoLive, Dreamweaver, and so on. Everything was in our software zoo in Munich. So you can see migration to an different platform, in this case, is a real opportunity to have one application for one functionality for the future. And the processes, service support, service delivery processes for one client should be the same, doesn't matter in which department they're used. Business applications. I told you in the beginning there have been two main decisions of our city council. One, to get free software and open standards running on our workstations. And the second, to get platform-independent business applications as investment for the future. But if we want to enforce this, our migration will be held until 2020, 2030, maybe, because that's not the world at the moment. Not every needed business application is web-based or offers a platform-independent client, for example, a Java client. In the past, you can say some .NET or Mono client, but you know the ongoing discussion about software patents, Richard Stallman told us. So I will just talk about operating system independent solutions. That's not today. That's maybe tomorrow. New procurements can be made to achieve this. But in the meantime, to go on with this migration project, we have to do something other. And we decided to use interim solutions, and many of them. Not only one. Of course, we can run everything in a virtualization, for example, VirtualBox image. Yes, that may be one possibility. But the other possibility is to use some one-time environments like Wine, for example. If it's possible for this application, and this application won't be changed in the future, for example, a non-updatable old proprietary software, we can use Wine. Why not? And another option is to use a terminal server, for example. So it's not only a choice to be made between black and white. There's a large part of gray between these two colors, and we are using this grayscale, though we can go on. And that's one of the success factors of our base client migration, not to wait until everything is fine, but to go on in small steps and continue. Okay, you've heard about the history, the policy behind. I told you something about our open office migration, which was ongoing. I told you about our migration to our Linux-based client, about our business applications, and now what we have learned during the last 6 years. One thing is standardization, yes. Of course, if you standardize your products, your software, your processes, you will win. But if you're doing too much, if you're doing too much standardization, then you will only standardize and standardize and standardize and standardize and standardize. You can always do something better than now, and you won't get on. So do standardization, but look for interim solutions, for steps you can go now. Maybe it's not the best step, but to go on and do it. Another thing is one of the most important. Of course, we are switching the Office product. Of course, we are switching the operating system. And you will agree that's a really technical project. In Munich, they have done many things with software, and they do a lot of funny technical things. No, that's not the point. Free software is up to date in every opinion. Free software, you can use free software. There are no problems using free software now for daily business. The real challenge in our project is the change management of users to deal with emotions, to deal with users being afraid of changes coming to them, to deal with users being afraid of power they will lose, for example, if there's a consolidation process, and so on. And that's much more difficult to change the soft factors of such a project than the hard facts, than the software. Usually I'm talking to public administrations, for example, at the European Commission or the federal government or to other public authorities coming to us. And that's my message. That's my message to every other public authority. Yes, now it's time. We can do it. Most of them know that free software and open standards are the backbone of today's society. If you switch off free software, the internet will collapse at this exactly moment. But what many of them don't imagine is that it's up to them. It's up to them to act for the future. Remember, there's an economic crisis now. There's a financial crisis now throughout the whole world. And we as public administration use the money from our taxpayers. We use the money from our taxpayers, for example, to increase the shareholder value of one single proprietary company. It can't be true. It can't be true. It's a great opportunity now to get a double benefit from this situation. If we, as public administration, invest in free software and open standards, there are two benefits for us. At first, the investment, the money for enhancements, for solved bugs, and so on. The money goes directly to small and medium-sized companies, locally, or nationally, or on your continent. Speaking as German in Europe, speaking from other continents, of course, in your continent. So the money is in your economy. And the second benefit is we have public administration have the opportunity, we have the possibility to give back the results of the work which has been done for us. We can give back every work, every result, every line of code which was programmed for us. This increases the knowledge, again, in your economy. And nowadays, it's time for networking about public administrations. There are some initiatives, there are some in Germany. I can talk about one in Europe. Maybe you would visit osoa.eu, the open source observatory and repository founded and operated by the European Union. And the only message of OSOA is bringing together interested public communities to join a network, to do something together with free software and open standards, and not to rely on proprietary standards, closed formats. So I hope you've heard what's the current status in Munich. I hope you've heard that free software and open standards, in my opinion, are the right way to solve problems, to solve a crisis like now. And if you have any questions, please ask now or ask them in the future. Contact us. Thank you very much. Are there any questions now? Yes, please.
Thank you. I'm curious. You say that there is a lot of pain and resistance to change. Do you think that in the future, let's say 5 years down the road, OpenOffice 4 and Debian whatever will come and you have to change for whatever reason? You decide that supporting the old infrastructure is too hard and you want to switch to a newer releases, newer versions of open source software. Do you think there will be the same kind of resistance? I mean, will it not happen the same way as switching from Microsoft to a certain version of Debian?
You mean if we are migrating inside one solution?
Yes.
Oh, I don't. I think it's the emotional resistance is because of people are aware of the public news. The news media talks about the opening Munich to free software and David contra Goliath and so on, and it was published and everyone talked about this, and it was something very special to our employees being cited in the newspaper, for example. And I think if we would have just switched the software without saying anything, there would be no problem. But it's my opinion. Any more questions? Yes, please.
Do you remember and estimate phase? Was there a comparative estimate of how much would it cost for you to upgrade to newest Windows versions and other Microsoft software?
Yes, it was. We compared five alternatives from a Microsoft operating system, Microsoft Office product, and Microsoft operating system and open source Office product, and open source operating system, open source Office product, and something between there. And it was a matter of the timeline. We decided to estimate or to calculate 5 years as our political decision timeline. It was quite clear to us if we calculated the cost to, for example, 3 years, then the Microsoft solution would have won, because not changing anything is mostly one of the more or the less costs. If we calculated a timeline for about 10 years, there wouldn't have been any chance to Microsoft. But 5 years, the costs were nearly equal. And that was the point. We can tell our city council the costs are nearly equal. The strategic factors are even nearly equal. And now, dear city council, dear politicians, decide, what's your strategy? Do you want a short-term strategy using the same proprietary software and getting the vendor lock-in? Or do you want a long-term strategy to be aware, to be free of this vendor lock-in? And our city council decided. But calculating the five-year period, there have been nearly equal costs for both solutions. Any more question, please? Okay, then thank you very much and enjoy the DevConf.